one of Cava's finest restaurants, Mamma Mia's, with manager Mike DeBonner. Mike, welcome to the Game Board.
Thank you. Nice to meet you. Anyway, basically, I'd like to say that, you know, Mamma Mia's been around since 1974. You know, Pat and John started up in Kingston. Many people on the South Shore know a lot about us. We've got six stores, including Carver. It's the newest addition to the Mamma Mia's chain, but they have one in Hanover, Plymouth on the waterfront, down in Kingston and Marshfield. They also own Camilla's. Pat and John basically passed the business down to Gina and Tony and Johnny and Sammy. And been in business, you know, basically, you know, almost forever, since 74. In this area, just worldwide, known from pizza all the way to filet mignon now. You know, Cava's come a long way, and today I'd like to show you how to cook some game in our record, because a lot of the family values that they've had is actually growing up and, you know, hunting and fishing and family values, and this is part of it, especially in this part of the world. So if we could start today with some, you know, beautiful cut whitetail, basically filet mignon. It's the exact same thing you'd get a tenderloin. I have some garlic, some salt, some pepper. It's usually a little coarse pepper, some coarse salt, some fresh parsley. We're just gonna rub a couple of these tenderloins, kind of pretty heavy with the seasoning, a lot heavier than people always think, because it comes off in the grill. So when you're at home and you're cooking, a lot of people are afraid to use too much seasoning and rub stuff in and get it all nice and what I call saturated with the nice spice. So we're gonna do two of them up like that. Me personally, like to put a little olive oil just on them. I like to use the best of olive oil too, just because it helps one for sticking on the grill. You could use a Pam spray, or you could use, you know, regular Wesson oil at home, but technically if you use the better product you use for all this stuff, the better it's gonna come out. So once you rub your filet down, put it right on the grill. Now, before we started, you know, trimming, the one big thing with venison, there's a lot of silver tone, they call it, on the back of a filet mignon or a loin, which is like a fatty, silvery type piece of meat. Now, you gotta make sure with all your venison that you try to get that off there, so you're just left with the pure redness of a, you know, and none of that white silver stone. It's very tough and chewy and adds the gamey flavor. Now, a lot of game, if you take care of it from start to finish. If I cook this filet mignon up, in my opinion, it just comes out just like a filet mignon at a store. There's no gamey taste. It's very good for you. It's high in protein. There's no fat in it, like where cows and all the stuff that we buy at the supermarket has a lot more fat in it than wildlife out there. So this is actually very rich. And very, very healthy for you, and you don't have to cook it really any different if it's done right from the start. So what we do is when we put it on the grill over here, you'll see that you'll have it. You'll leave it there for about 3 minutes on each side. You're gonna give it a quarter turn. When you give it your quarter turn, you can make some marks on it. We'll flip it over. We'll do the exact same thing. It takes about 10 to 12 minutes to cook an average size, probably deer loin on the grill. And over here, what we did is we started some mushrooms, some peppers, some onions, some garlic, some same exact ingredients that we basically have marinating the meat with. And then we just chopped them up real small, and we sauteed that in a little olive oil just to give it, you only have to cook that for about, that's been cooking for about 5 or 10 minutes. After that loin is done, we're gonna bring it over, we're gonna put it on a sizzle platter, they call it. You're gonna put it in your oven. We're gonna top it with a little bit of that mixture, some provolone cheese, put it in the oven for a minute or two, and then from that point, we'll pull it out, we'll put it right on the plate. We're gonna do a little sauce with it today. What we like to do here at the restaurant is take a little bit of butter and flour, that's what this is here, and a little bit of demi-glaze. Now, demi-glaze you can get at a store, you can buy it. It's basically veal bones boiled down with a bunch of vegetables until you get a jelly type substance that's where all the flavor comes from, and chicken masala and all your main beef stock dishes or reductions. So if you take a little butter, a little of that beef stock, we warm it up. We're just gonna heat that up, and you could add a little red wine into that. We could add a little red wine, a little fresh parsley, and we'll just reduce that down to a sauce. Sorry about the phone.
Mike, you cooked this for my office mate, John Duffy, and I have to listen every day to Jed talking about your tenderloin cook here at Mama Mia's and how good it was.
Well, Jed's in here about 3 days a week, and he loves food, and one day we were just messing around with a deer I shot, and basically he was out there sitting down, and we cooked him up the exact same way, and he thought it was the best piece of filet mignon he's ever had, even best loin he's ever had. He goes, that's the best loin I've ever had from a deer. And the big trick is not wrecking. A lot of people, you know, and I think a lot of the big mistake in my years of cooking is they all think it's going to taste gamey, and it usually starts from whenever the animal was harvested. You know, everybody hangs it up in their shed or drives around with it on their car or whatever they're doing, but if you just treat it like, you know, everybody else does, and you hang it at the proper temperature, and you butcher it correctly, you wrap it right, you put it in your freezer, and you eat it within 3 months. That is the main thing. Like, even in a freezer, it doesn't last 2 years. And if you just do it right, you know, and have it when it's at quality time, and you cook it just like you cook any steak at home, I really think, and the most people would never even know that that was, you know, venison, in my opinion. I really do.
If it's gamey, it's been cooked.
Yeah. Yeah,
and I think the older I get, the more I realize that the key to it is, like you say, not keep trying to keep it for 2 years.
Exactly. That it, you know, it, you get most things, you just want it to move out within 6 months. You know, like before the next hunting season, my father always used to say, you know, make sure you get rid of it. You know, like we're already into almost summertime here, right? The season's been over 3 or 4 months. Most people probably have only eaten a couple packs of their venison. And you know, the hunting season will be here, and they'll still have packs in their freezer, and then they bring it to the hunting camp, and by that point the product is already really slightly damaged. You know, stuff, even everything in the freezer just doesn't stay like people think. You know, because nobody has the airtight vacuum packs. I mean, you might have it, but it's not commercial grade, and you know, the air quality definitely wrecks it, and freezer breaks it down, and it just changes the whole product. You know, so, you know, it's an extremely good product, and with the way prices are going up, you know, and the gas prices, people might be, you know, wanting to enjoy more of this as time goes on. So
any good recipe starts with quality ingredients.
All right, so as the mushrooms, peppers, and onions are almost done, just kind of work on this demi-glaze here. Like I said, it's just butter, a little flour, some demi-glaze. You can buy demi-glaze right at the supermarket. You can add a little bit of, you know, you could technically add a little bit of this garlic and salt and pepper in there just to season it up a little bit more. I added a splash of red wine in there, and then you just slow cook that for while your tenderloin's cooking. The whole process basically that we're doing here should take, you know, from start to finish once you have the meat out and everything like that and thawed, you know, a half an hour. You could do this on the grill and have your meal done at home, you know, which is the big thing.
And if it's done properly, you'd think you were eating at a high-class restaurant.
Oh, well, that's the thing. It's not as hard. A lot of the food that we cook, and John and Pat, and one thing I'll say about Italian food is it's basic. It's quality. We cook everything to order. You know, we don't do anything fancy. It's good olive oil. It's salt. It's pepper. It's butter. It's garlic. You know, it's fresh food cooked, you know, just at when it's at its best. And, you know, it's no secret what we do here. The reason why it's better here than at a chain is because it's not coming in a microwave. You know, we have two microwaves right there. We use them to warm up vegetables and get the lasagna hot in the center before we cook it off. You know, those, you know, we don't really cook with microwaves. If you go in a commercial restaurant these days, you'll see 11 microwaves across the top. Everything's in bags. You know, it's just the way the world's going. Where at Mama Mia's, you know, they're known for just doing high-end, real dough. We make our dough every day. You know, with pizza, we buy the freshest product that we can possibly get at the best price. We give you the biggest portion, and we put it out. And that's really what it's been all about for 30-something years. So
well, you started here in Cava, what, 2007, 2008?
2007 in October, and we were known pretty much as a pizza shop, and we started to do what Camella's does, is deal with, you know, the specials and try to get things rolling with quality food, and it just kept growing. People in this, even though it's a small hometown, Carver's a great town. I mean, it's one of those small towns that's very close community, I would call it. Very nice people, and it's, you know, it's not too big where you don't get to know everybody. Everybody here is like a family restaurant. It really is. It's the nicest feeling to have that type of community. You know, the fire department, police department, the town hall, they all seem to really get along. And I worked in a lot of towns. This town's very tight, in my opinion.
A lot of the, Mama Mia's does a lot of good community work. You've supported since you came to Cava. the Cava Sports Club Scholarship Breakfast that we do that allows us to do scholarships for local seniors graduating from high school. And we always send a couple of kids to the Mass Junior Conservation Camp. And that's an outstanding program. The kids that come back from the conservation camp have been taught hunter safety, boater safety, archery, and they just come back just enthusiastic about that program. And we've actually had a couple go to the camp and again as counselors in the following years, which is nice.
No, it is. Anything that teaches the kids these days how to get out in the, and basically enjoy the wildlife, to, you know, and see it, it seems like that's less and less harder to do the way the kids are going. So anything like that, I try to support. And the family, actually, the whole family hunt. They all hunt and they all fish. Surprisingly, they have a camp up in, you know, Vermont. They all hunt right down here in South Plymouth, and they go to the gun clubs and Carver Sportsman Club. They're a very big part of that. And you'd be surprised how often they're out there gobbling a turkey, like probably today. Well, right. You can't do it today, but they were out there yesterday in the pouring rain. I know that because they were telling me how they got soaked. So.
We had our third annual youth turkey hunt, not this Saturday, but a week ago, and the kids harvested 10 birds. And just to see the enthusiasm on the kids' faces when they came by with their birds, just it's awesome. You see the kids out with their parents, a few other activities that they get with their parents. In modern times, they're sitting there texting and emailing and everything else, and we're actually getting them out with their parents, yeah. Which is nice.
Yeah, now Jed was basically telling me that he had a picture of one of the young girls. And it was nice to see a female actually out there. She was about 17 years old, and she was holding up her bird. And it was nice to see that, you know, it's gone, you know, since I've been a kid, I think hunting's gone a long way as far as, you know, basically all men. Now it's a lot of women. You see them on TV, the clothesline, everything. It's changing good. And, you know, it's becoming more of a family tradition, a whole family tradition, yeah. Which is kind of nice.
20% of the kids that participated in the youth turkey hunt were female, and actually
oh, really?
Two out of three of those bagged birds.
Really?
Two out of three.
They got more patience than we do, probably.
I think.
All right, so basically this filet mignon over here, we've been cooking it for 10 or 12 minutes. It's just about there. It's definitely rare right now. We're going to continue to cook that for one more minute. The reduction here is just about done, and the mushrooms, onions and peppers are good. So what you can do from this point is throw it right on at home on a casserole dish. Take a little bit of these mushrooms, peppers and onions, kind of stack them right on there. Like that. Put it up here, maybe get a good shot of that. Then what I do is we take a little bit of provolone cheese, we wrap it right on there. Like that. And we're just gonna put that in the oven for a couple of minutes. When you use your oven at home, you wanna use the top of your oven. Basically, is the hottest part of your oven as heat rises, most people know. While we're waiting for that, one other thing I'd like to say about venison is, you know, it has no fat in it. I was trying to tell you how basically, how without fat when you overcook venison, it gets tough really fast, or it gets dry. So you don't want to cook it really more than medium. If you do like it well done or medium well, try not to go over once the medium well of venison, because it does dry out. But if you want to do well done, I would recommend steak cutlets, where you slice it nice and thin and just put a little egg wash and a little flour, pan fry it in some olive oil, and have it drizzled with a little red sauce at home, and you'd be surprised how much tenderer and tastier that will be, because you hold it in the moisture with the egg wash, the flour, the butter and the oil and all that. That, you know, if you have to have your meat cooked at a well done temperature. But if you like it on the medium and below, grilling it and doing it the way we're doing it will work perfectly fine.
That's great advice for wild game, almost any game. And the longer you cook it, the drier it gets and the tougher it gets.
Yeah, you know, and unless you're doing a stew, and I mean when you harvest a deer, you know, you take the loins, you take the rear quarters, and that's the stuff that's all your steaks. You should do it on the grill, or you know, saute it as a nice cutlet. You know, cutlets are my favorite. You know, a little olive oil, garlic in a pan with some salt, pepper, maybe a pinch of Italian seasoning. You know, wash it in flour and egg, throw it in a pan, fry it even medium, cook that with a little bit of red sauce on the side, you know, just like you do a chicken cutlet. Do it with venison, real thin, the same exact way, and you would be surprised. That is, it's almost like country fried steak, but it's country fried venison. You don't need the white cheesy Alfredo sauce dumped all over it to wreck it. Just eat that plain with a little salt on it, a little red sauce on the side, and that is truly my favorite way to have venison. This would be my second favorite way, because, you know, these days that is such a nice piece of meat, like you said, that I'd hate to, you don't want to wreck it at all if you don't have to.
And if you're on a diet, the Weight Watchers assigns a very low number of points to venison and other wild game because it doesn't have the fat. So if you're on a diet, it's perfect.
Older people, I mean, these days doctors are recommending it. I mean, it's unbelievable how much, I mean, like I said, without the fat in it, the big thing with American, as you know, like this day and age, is the fatness of it. You know, we're trying to buy all our oils, our frying oils, everything with no trans fat. That's one of the big things. The other thing would be just trying to have a healthier meal. We're actually teaming up with Jordan Hospital right now on a haddock dish, which is haddock Italian, which just has a little Italian dressing in it, tomatoes, a little pinch of breadcrumbs, and they're going to sponsor us for a healthier America. So, like, Mamma Mia is totally focused right now. Every day, what we try to do is make the menu healthier. So we have hots on the menu telling you what you should eat. And if I could buy venison at a better price, I would probably have it on the menu. The problem is, if you buy fallow deer or any kind of venison like that, you have to go through a proper food vendor to have it in the store. And the price point is just, with this economy, you can't afford to really do that. But technically, we are working on trying to have, we have all kinds of things come in here. I've done rabbit, and we did do venison. We brought venison. I brought buffalo in, you know, so we have bison and field grain. I buy a natural product that has no steroids in it, chicken product and stuff. So the world is definitely going in that direction, and we are definitely focused on trying to make it go that way. So
what we're trying to do is prevent us having to have a defibrillator in every restaurant.
Exactly, because, you know, the big thing is we just don't eat, you know, those, like I said, those chain restaurants. They've been feeding you a lot of salt and a lot of fat for a long time, so we're trying to get away from that. All right, so we look in here. You know, basically that's perfect. Now, what I would like to do, and what I did with Jed, one of your guys down at the club, is we basically take one of these loins, put it right in the center of the plate, like that. You take a little bit of your reduction here. If it doesn't, if you're at home and you're cooking a reduction and it breaks or anything like that, or it just doesn't look good, if you throw a little cold butter in there and just give it a little stir, the sauce will come right back, be nice and glossy. This sauce right here is perfect. Just kind of do a little bit of a drizzle right down the middle like that. And basically, we'd serve that with anything on the side, but there's nothing better than mushrooms, peppers, and onions, in my opinion. It's almost like the Italian sub. And if I had a little bit of mushroom tortellini or some ravioli or some little angel hair to put on the side or some roasted potatoes, I would put that right on the other side, and we'd sprinkle it here. We do like a little bit of a garnishing job, and
that's something almost anybody can do at home with a little bit of practice, and you'll be eating like a king.
You know, and if you we can actually slice that for you if you want to see what it would look like. You want me to do that, or you know, if you take a, you know, and the big thing with this, I'm gonna cut it for you now. But the big one more tip with filet mignon or any kind of tenderloin at home, one thing I'd always recommend is to let that sit. So when we take it out of the oven and I put it, you know, basically here, what we would like to do in a restaurant, which we don't always have time to do, as you can imagine, on Friday and Saturday night, would be to take something like this, put it on the plate, and let it sit there for about 10 minutes. That would be ideal. The longer that rests and gels up, the tenderer, the juices all stay in it, it doesn't get wrecked. So if you could cook them, a lot of times we'll cook a whole loin ahead of time at 4 o'clock. We'll leave it right on the oven, and then we'll wait for customers to come in 5:30 and slab it out. Once you, like, almost like prime rib, that's how prime rib's done. You have it under a heat light, you just keep it at the, you know, one, you're supposed to keep everything at 140 or above, so you just try to hold the temperature as long as you can, let that meat rest, and the longer it rests, the better it is. So when you're at home, you have all the time in the world. I recommend that you cook it and don't cut it right away. Cook all your steaks first, let them rest, and then work on your vegetables or your rice or your pasta at home, and let that sit 15, 20 minutes. Recently at home, I just did a whole loin. The whole deer loin was right on the grill. I roasted all up, that sat for 30 to 40 minutes. I cut it all up, gave it to people. They thought it was the best piece of meat that they've ever had, and she's been in New York. My sister's been to New York, and everything's like, oh, it's the best piece of meat I've ever had in my whole life. So very important to let it sit. But I just want to show you that, you know, when we cut this open, I cooked it, you know, basically really, you know, that's cooked, you know, to me that's medium, medium rare. As you go up, it's going to get rarer, but that's, you know, down the end of the tail here, we're looking at medium. You go up here where the fatter part, you know, you're going to get down to a medium rare where it's still purple in the middle. But to me, that's as tender as you can get, and that's just going to be absolutely delicious.
I think that's the number one thing that people do wrong. They overcook. They think there's something wrong with it. They think it's germy. It's quite the opposite. Any wild game properly prepared and properly cared for in the field and prepared properly for the freezer, when you get it, there's absolutely nothing wrong with it. You don't have that animal hanging in with a lot of other animals with E. coli and everything else. No. These things are clean, they're healthy, and there's no reason to overcook it.
No, and I can't agree with you more. It starts from the day you shoot it. You know, you gotta, you know, basically the day you harvest that animal, you know what you're doing from that point, get it home. There's nothing better, you know, same with fishing, you know, it's all the same. You go out there and get it yourself, there's no better product.
That's right.
And there's no reason to treat it any different than anything you do at home. It's all the same stuff.
Well, Mike, I think the next order of business is for us to adjourn to the dining room for the game glutton. So.
All right,
thank you for appearing.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
I'd like to point out that Tony Viscarello is an active participant in the Friends of the NRA. The Friends of the NRA is our nonprofit wing of the NRA that supports youth programs, hunter education, land conservation, and firearm safety programs. Tony always sponsors a table at that event, and these grants that we give out are used for range safety improvements, hunter education, and other charitable organizations. These grants have benefited the town of Carver by improving the range safety of the Carver Sportsman's Club. We added 18 inches of clean sand to the back berm of the rifle range because Carver is a growing community and the neighbors are getting closer and closer to the facility. So we elected to apply for the range safety grant, and we were able to use local contractors. We used Jeff Thomas up in North Carver. Jeff's a great guy. He was easy to work with, and we highly recommend him for any kind of excavation needs. The town also benefited because now we can offer the police department the use of the rifle range. We really appreciate the chance to improve the training costs for the town of Carver. We appreciate the courtesy that's been extended on the last two chiefs of police for the sportsmen in the town. Both Chief Parker and Mike Mix have been very courteous to us and extended us many, many courtesies along the way. We are grateful for the opportunity to help. So without further ado, what I'd like to do is start eating the game that we've taken. And again, nice, easy preparation, Mike. It was a great job. We really appreciate it. We appreciate having Mamma Mia's in the town of Carver because it's a great restaurant, and I think it's your flagship store myself.
Well, thank you very much, and thank you for having us on, and hopefully you'll enjoy your meal.
Thank you.
My favorite kind of shirt, so.
Yes. Now I'm going to find out what, if Jen was right.
Oh, it'll be it.
Now Jen's going to have to listen to me for the next 6 months. Jen is a regular here at Mount Vegas. We make our way at least once a week to the Hanover branch for lunch.
Well, Hanover's definitely just got remodeled too, and Tony, that you said sponsored a table, he's probably the biggest outdoor activist I know in the family. He's out there all the time. He's out every morning. And he loves it. Like I said, the other day he gets stuck in that. He had lightning and rain and had his little top on, and turkeys gobbling all around him, but he didn't get anything. But he was out there trying.
Well, you know, if you got something every time you went out, it would be fun.
Basically what we did here too is, I was talking about potatoes and stuff like that. Again, a lot of times people now, we do high protein, low fat meats, and we try to accompany it with a salad. You know, something a little healthier for you. You can have a little cheese, you can have a little oil. It's not like you can't have these things. You just gotta try to change your plate a little bit. So on your plate, I gave you a little artichoke salad with some olives, and a little tiny bit of cheese, a little bit of lettuce, some, you know, high-end ingredients, very healthy for you, very fresh. And that is the key to try to, a little red wine. They're talking red wine, nothing better than red wine to help you. You know, the antioxidants in a red wine, too. Again, it's extremely healthy. One day this will be at CVS. They'll be selling red wine at CVS. I'm telling you, it's the way it's going to happen.
That artichoke salad is good.
Very good.
The great thing about these recipes is they're simple and easy to use.
You definitely don't have to go way out of your way to try to make something fancy and put jelly on it and boil it down and cook it. And all kinds. A lot of people just seem to take game and bury it with stuff and try to hide that flavor. I mean, you're eating it right now. I mean, in my opinion, that tastes as good as any piece of steak you get right at the store with no seasoning and, you know, all on there, a little salt and pepper and a little garlic, and there's not much on there, you know.
I think what it does is it enhances the natural flavor of the meat.
Exactly. You don't have to bury it in that.
That reduction sauce.
The barbecue sauces, and not that that stuff isn't nice, and all that stuff is great. I love all the sauces, but you don't have to do it that way. If you like plain food, you can do it with that wildlife, you know. So it is extremely, extremely good if it's cured right. You've been out hunting it all this year.
That's one of my biggest vices. I was out yesterday morning trying to get myself a turkey. This day, the youth hunt, which was not this past Saturday, but the Saturday before, my kids took 10 turkeys, the largest of which was 2,200 pounds. I think of my kids in the range from 12 to 17. It's just a fantastic program. I over and over again, as the kids came back, they were out there hunting with their father or, you know, one of the adult sportsmen that we have. And to see kids out there with their dads in a setting where they're really equals. In the teen years, it's hard to find those kind of venues.
No, I have three little ones, so I know that, you know, when my kids eventually get to the right age to get out there, which they're not there yet. I'm hoping that, like you said, the 20% of the girls, I'm hoping I get one out of two, right?
Right.
I know that's a 50% ratio, but I'm hoping that it gets that high in a few more years.
Well, I think, you know, there's nothing that stops women from appreciating the outdoors just like we do. The more people get involved in it, the more they realize that it's not all about the kill. It's all about the process and about getting out, sitting down in the woods on a nice spring day.
When you run this restaurant on Friday night, you heard the phones ringing probably earlier on the video. We're trying to shoot the video and the phones are ringing. You know, Friday night there's 700 people trying to eat. You got staff, you got customers, you're talking. The best thing in the whole world is when I'm up in a tree 20 feet and there's a squirrel looking at me and I'm up there trying to do a deer hunt. I sit there for 9 hours, and if nothing comes in, I'm fine with it. That's the best. There is nothing better than that. You got nobody around you, and sometimes that is the best, is just hiding in a tree with no cell phones, no kids, no wife, no work. And to me, that is what outdoors is all about. It's not whether I actually get the animal, I'll be honest. That's not the main part for me, I'll be honest.
Well, more often than not, if the truth were known, when we're out in the woods, we're not getting any.
Well, nine times out of ten, right?
I know. 2 years ago, I was duck hunting out in South Dakota with my son, and we had a bald eagle fly over us about 8:30, and that was the highlight of the day.
You never know what the highlight of the day is going to be. Something weird always happens when you're out there. The big thing is going out there and trying to do it, you know?
Right.
There's always a memory that you got to grow with the family when you're out there. I've had more memories from things going wrong than going right.
Sometimes you don't appreciate what a trophy means. I mean, it can mean different things at different times in your life. In 1972, I bagged a nice 11-pointer, weighed in at 218. And at the time, I think I appreciated my parents got the head mount. But over time, that head mount is hanging on my wall means more to me in terms of what my parents did at a difficult time financially in their life to lay out the money to put out for that head mount. Oh, yeah. It's more to me now than the head mount itself.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. I just picked one up the other day. I shot a six-pointer in New York last year. Again, and tonight I have a similar situation. I have a kind of a collection of them. And my first one, too, my father was, you know, a single dad growing up with me a lot. My mother and them were split up. And he used to take me on trips with no money. I could remember driving all the way up to the Berkshires and doing a big hunting trip. And I'm sure that first deer I have on my wall was probably something he didn't want to pay for. But he knew that that was a memory thing that meant a lot to him. To this day, I look up there, actually, you know, it's one of those things that I go, that's my first deer ever, you know. Even though it's not the biggest deer in the world, but... Not an 11-pointer. It didn't weigh 218, but it has
special place.
It does. It absolutely does. And my kids growing up to this day see all that, and they love the outdoors. All three of them do right now, but they're up 10 and under, so we'll see how it goes. But every day they want to take a walk in the woods, just to take a walk or take pictures. They don't want to, you know, my daughters always say, you know, I don't want to kill anything. I'm like, that's fine. We'll go up to the tree and we'll take pictures, you know. Like, whatever it is to get them outside and get them out there and seeing tracks and going through the snow and just being outside. I just don't think anybody, they don't do it as much as they used to. But it's sad that it's not done the way it used to be. And kids are so entertained by it. It's like the whole day you can spend out there, and they are just intrigued by all the little things, whether it's the moss or the needles or the birds singing or anything you show them. They're overwhelmed with joy out there. It's great.
I think one of the guys on that last year, we were doing the walkthrough, and one of the girls, I pointed out to her, Twitter berries around Miles Sanders. I pointed out that's what the birds eat. And I bent down, like, I picked one for her, and I had her eat it. And that was the highlight of her, of the event of her.
She learned something, she was so excited, right?
Right. She learned something new that she didn't.
Yeah, no, I'm telling you, that's the best part about kids. I mean, they really do enjoy being out there, you know, fishing. I mean, I took my son fishing for the first time, and we brought back a couple little pickerel, and we had some two bass. And we flayed them. I flayed them in front of them. I showed them how there was a crawfish inside the bass. There was a full crawfish in there that the bass must have just ate. Flayed them. I fried them. I literally caught it, came home, flayed it, and cooked it. So it was a lot, you know, in the pond alive an hour before we ate it. And he sat there and ate the whole fish and thought it was the best thing since sliced bread. He goes, you know, to see it all happen that fast, you know. And he's a five-year-old boy, and he loves fish, and he has a shellfish allergy, so it's even more important that he can have fish, but he can't have the shellfish by him. And, you know, he loves every minute of that. He thought it was the best day of his life to catch a few little fish, bring them home and cook them, and I show him how to clean them, and really got a little good kick out of it, you know. Like, kids love that stuff. They really do.
Well, and I think they enjoy spending time with their mom and dad. And they do up until the time they're about 12. That's one of the things that these hunts are good for. When they're 12 and they don't want to be seen in public with mom and dad, on these youth hunts, there's a special relationship that's somewhat different than the adult years. They're there with an adult mentor, that somebody other than, that they consider something other than their parents. It's somebody with valuable information that they want, they need, and the situation is reversed. We've seen these kids bring their A game every time. Safety conscious.
Well, you know, 12 to 18 kids get so shy, you drop them off. They don't want kissing a hug from dad no more. And, you know, it's great to get them out in the woods, and maybe they're out of their, you know, their friends, quote unquote, this whole school and electronic age, and bring them out there and go have some real fun with them and see that their emotions come out the way they should naturally, you know, instead of hiding behind the texting like you were talking about earlier. That's all everybody does now, text. And that's definitely a great way the world's going, but in one way it kind of takes the relationship away in so many ways to go out there and go do something with your child. You know?
Right. I think this fits well, too, with today's episode when we talk about Mama Mia's family traditions and being a family restaurant, you know, hunting and fishing, and outdoor activities, no matter what you do. So the time you spend out with your kids is cherished family time that can't be duplicated anywhere else. And we really appreciate having you on the Game Gourmet today, and look forward to many good years of having Mama Mia's here as a good citizen of the town of Cobb. So thank you very, very much, Mike. We appreciate having you.
Thank you very much. It was great.